Penny, you've been writing poetry for a long time. Did you always feel that you had to write?
Well, I started writing poetry when I was 4 years old, and I couldn't even write. My father wrote it down for me. And then I began to write what one could only call play poetry. I mean, one verse went, "Naughty Dinah Dewdrop of number 22 fell off from David Daisy and wondered what to do." But it wasn't saying any great things, you know, it wasn't thinking poetry. And I suppose, like any adolescent, I wrote poetry that I never wanted to be seen by the outside world. And then gradually in the early 70s moved on to what you'd call left-wing poetry, I think, but it was mainly based on a deep sense of what fair play was. And only very recently, in the last few years, have I started to write for women and about women. But I think it's something I've always done. It's very difficult to answer that question because it's just the most effective way I find of communicating what I want to and what I feel.
What is the purpose, then, of your poetry?
I think that's changed over the years. As I say, like many other teenagers, writing poetry was a kind of emotional release and essentially a very private thing. I think a lot of women poets particularly, they're there writing poetry, but they're keeping it very much to themselves because they're embarrassed that, you know, maybe it's not up to standard or maybe it doesn't rhyme and it isn't proper poetry. I think I am more clear now that I've started to write, if you want to put labels on it, feminist poetry. I'm much clearer about what I'm trying to achieve. I think, first of all, I use deliberately very simple language. And that is for a number of reasons, the most obvious reason being that I want to be understood by ordinary people. And I feel very strongly that poetry is a popular art and it's not an elitist thing where it's just for the initiated few. I mean, T.S. Eliot wrote a poem and then wrote notes at the end of it. And I think those notes to explain the poem are actually an admission of failure. So I write this simple language, trying to use language that people use every day. And that's not difficult to do, because if you listen to people's language, it's actually full of very vivid imagery anyway. And beyond the language, I mean, once you've got that, that people are going to read your poems and understand them, and there's no excuse for making them incomprehensible at all, then you go on to the content and what you're actually trying to say. And it took me a long time to realize, and this was a lack of confidence again, like I think many women feel, that women's issues and women's feelings were actually worth talking about. And that when a woman does the washing up or cares for her children, that is an important thing. And you start from there. I mean, it's a good old community work, women's movement precept.
For a step into confidence, is it?
Yes, for building up confidence. Also for, it's a hackneyed phrase now, starting where the people are at.
But no, you've said that. You want to get to the people. That includes men, doesn't it?
I think men, yes. I'm not so bothered about them, really. I mean, I think they've held the stage long enough. And that their values are often, perhaps they've been forced into holding those values, but they're often to do with aggression. And that the female values of compassion and caring are things that get undervalued, and it's about time that women poets get on that stage and say these are the things that are important.
But for instance, your poem Curfew, surely it's more important for men to understand that message than for women who already know it.
Yes. I don't know that all women would see it in those terms, actually. I think a lot of women are still frightened and use this word confidence again, lacking in confidence, and they therefore would stay in their homes. I mean, what it is a rallying call to say, look, this is bad, isn't it? What are you doing sitting at home like that? Don't you want the freedom of the streets, the freedom to go out like anybody else? And there's also this thing which I think comes across more in some of my other poems. Like the heroines, for instance, that once you've said something like, we meet in the afternoon over tea and we talk about all our unfulfilled dreams and what we could have been if only we didn't have children and married, then women stop being isolated, which they've always tended to be isolated in the home. and they feel a common bond building between them. And they say, well, it's not just me, she feels that way too. But that's not enough. I mean, it's not just enough to identify. I think from that, you can start saying, why aren't we the heroines? Why is it just a dream? The poem should be saying, and I think it does, this is a possibility. Let's not just dream about it. How about starting to do it?
Can I ask you about this underlying anger, a feeling almost of venom in a lot of your work? How angry are you?
You're almost saying measure it. And certainly I am angry. I'm angry at not so much the waste in my own life, because I think I've been fortunate. I mean, it's been a long, hard battle, but I've got I've got the education, if you like. I've been fortunate in being born with certain talents, like writing poetry. But there are a lot of people who don't have the advantages that I have, and a lot of women whose lives could be so much better and that have been reduced to drudgery. Because I lived on a council estate for a while. I was a one-parent family as well as the people I was living with. And those women had so much to offer, and they were actually tied down by, like the poem says, they were scarred by groceries and washing up. And inside every one of those women was a wild woman, there was a heroine, and there was someone who could start on the journey I talked about, who with a bit of help from her friends could actually go on that journey towards independence.